and we also were discussing like a
Let me
perceptron.
go through a little bit.
Fine, thank you.
Okay.
So we were discussing something about the perceptron yesterday.
If you
We'll
have any
continue the
problem, please
class.
text it. I'll be
So
there in my office
perceptron,
room.
we were seeing that like it is the most basic form of a neural network, right? And we also were discussing like a perceptron is a simple model of a biological neuron in the form of an artificial neural network. And it is also the name of an early algorithm for supervised learning of binary classifiers. So for a only two class problem, this perceptron can work very well provided they are linearly separable. The perceptron algorithm was designed to classify patterns and groups by finding the linear separation between these different objects and patterns received through numeric or visual points, right? From the numbers or some visual from the visual points as the input, it can be easily separable, but only one condition for this is that they should be linearly separable. If they are non-linear in nature, if the data set is non-linear in nature, then definitely this single layer perceptron will not work good. Okay, it will not be sufficient enough to do the classification properly, even though it is a two class problem. So is an example was given here with the domestication data and the size of the animal. Like when two animals are there, then how the linearly separable line is given here, and if more samples of any class is being added, then how the linearly separable line can be plotted. Okay, so like here the dog was increased, number of dog was increased, so the linear separable line earlier from here to here it went, so again more of dogs, again some more cats also, so a linearly separable line was being drawn like this. And the mathematical model for this perceptron is also given here, stating that these are the inputs and we have a bias with some weights also for these inputs, and the summation of these inputs and this weights for these inputs, we told weights as the strength of that particular input, and this combined together we have a weighted sum, sum of all the weights combined with these inputs. Then this input is the net value that is given as the output. So this is assumed that this is being done in the nucleus of the neuron, and this has been passed through the axon, and then a step function is, or like a activation function is used here to activate the value or to fire, whether to fire the neuron or not to fire the neuron. So once fired, then the synaptic value is being passed, that information is being passed to the next neuron, and the dendrites of that particular neuron, the inputs of that particular neuron, input edges of that particular neuron will be responsible in taking that particular input. Now, so we were also seeing about the components of a perceptron as the inputs, right? Various inputs are available, right? We have the inputs here. So these are the inputs here. Okay, we were seeing that these are the list of inputs here. Now, then the weights and bias are also available. So this is the, so this either this constant, the bias, okay? Also along with that one, you have some weights also, all the weights associated with this inputs. Then also you have the net sum, which is function, or like you can say that summing up of all the weights, the product of weights and this, inputs. Then you have the activation function or a step function where it gives some bound for that particular value attained from this weighted sum. We were also discussing an example of a perceptron, stating that how linearly classification can be done for separable set of inputs. So given a data set like this, so what we can do is, these are the list of horses, some horses and some dogs are given here. So a random line, suppose it is given here initially. Here, if you, for this particular random line, we have seen that like one horse is misclassified and one dog is misclassified. It means that they are wrongly classified. So the error leads to two here, right? One dog and one horse. Then afterwards, this line has been readjusted such that this horse was brought into correct classification, but still the dog is not classified correctly. So here we have the error as 1. Now, afterwards, again, this line has been readjusted in such a way that the dogs and the horses are classified correctly. So here, any animal in this box, in this area, it corresponds to the class of dog, and any animal in this area comes under the class horses. So we were discussing this, right? So another thing we were discussing was that consider a equation of a line y equal to mx plus c. Now, why the movement of line is very much important. If you see earlier, what we were doing, the line from here, then we adjusted something here, then like this, okay? Then afterwards, again, we brought it like this. So making this one as the complete final line, linearly separable line like this, right? This was what was planned, got it. Now, so we have an equation of a line, y equal to mx plus c. Why should we move this line? Or what is the importance of this movement of this line? So for classification, the goal is to find the best line from all infinite positions. So any given like this, so you put up a line like anywhere, no issue. But from anywhere, the goal is to find the best line. Okay, we are interested in finding the best line such that we can separate these two classes as linearly separable. Hence, the core of perceptron is to find out the nudges or the edges with some weights, okay, fixing some weights. And also by doing for this line, by doing some rotations, M rotations, for example, the M is the slope, and C translations, okay, C is the intercept, for example, okay, C translations and M rotations, such that it can lead to the best line, the line that is intended here. Okay, now how do we find out then this best line? Let us see with example. And what are the operations are given there? We saw that earlier in this slide we saw that M rotations and C translations, right? This, so it means that rotation and translation, these are the two operations basically required here. So one is translation. What does translation say? Move the line up and down in a parallel way. So moving the line in a up and down parallel way. So this is the line. Okay, you can move this line either up or you can move this line either down, 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 wherever you want. You can do, suppose only three, these are two values are here, one here, one here, one here. Then you need a linear separable line here, then the rest of elements come on the other side, right? So move the line up and down in a parallel way. So this line, wherever you want, you can move up or down, you can move it, this one. Now, rotation, what is rotation operation? Move the points about the pivots. So this is for pivot on y axis. This is a pivot on x axis. So move the points about the pivots in the clockwise and anti-clockwise direction. So you want this one, for example, you want this one to be moved. Either you can move this one in a clockwise direction this way, or you can move this one in an anti-clockwise direction this way, no issue. Similarly, this one, you can move this one in a clockwise direction like this, you can move it, or you can move this one in an anti-clockwise direction, no issue. Okay, but at any given point of time, one of the operation will be in action. Now let us see rotating and translating how we do it. Suppose a line is given here, okay, 2x plus 3y is equal to 7. So it means that constant times x plus constant time y equal to the third constant here. Okay, it means 2x, it means that this 2 is the coefficient of x plus 3y, 3 is the coefficient of y, that is equal to some constant 7. Now what we can do is that this particular constant value on the right hand side can be brought on the left hand side, no issue. We have, so 2x plus 3y minus 7 is equal to 0. Okay, how we get it? This is the one. So 2x plus 3y plus minus 7 is equal to 0. It means that now when we change this C, basically this is the value of C, okay, intercept, or like this is the coefficient value of movement of this particular line. Now constant time X plus constant time Y plus another constant time Y was equal to zero now, okay, and increasing the value of minus 7, increasing the value of minus 7 shifts the line downwards, and decreasing the value of minus 7, this coefficient C, shifts the line up. So when you decrease this value, decrease this value in the sense like what happens here, if you are to decrease this value, you have to add something, right? Or increase or decrease, either add or subtract, you do it. So anything change particularly in this particular C value or like this coefficient value or constant value here, this one leads or results in moving this particular line either up or down. So increasing the value of minus 7 here, if you increase the value, then the line goes up. If you decrease this value, the line goes down. Let us see with example. Now similarly, if now what if we change the value of 2, the coefficient of X, or what if we change the value of 3, the coefficient of Y? Now with respect to 2, okay, now what if we change the value of 2? So increasing the value of 2 rotates the line clockwise along the pivot point. So it means that if you increase the value, it goes down like this. This is the pivot, okay, X pivot. This is the X pivot, this is the X axis, and this is the X pivot. This X pivot, basically, it goes down like this. It goes down like this if you increase the value of 2. 2 to 3, for example, it goes down like this. If 2 to 1 you bring it, it goes like this. So decreasing the value of 2 rotates the line anti-clockwise along the pivot point. So this is the pivot point, either clockwise or anti-clockwise direction, this move. It means that this line, if you do it, suppose minus 1, then it means that 1x plus 3y, then it comes like this. Suppose you make it 3x, something like this, the line is like this. So it means that this line is shifted here, right? This is rotation, this is rotation. Similarly for the 3y, okay, if you do it for 3y, what happens is that increasing the value of 3 rotates the line anti-clockwise. This is anti-clockwise direction, and decreasing the value of 3 rotates the line in the this is the clockwise direction. Increasing the value of 3 rotates the line in anti-clockwise direction. So this is anti-clockwise direction, and decreasing the value of 3 rotates the line clockwise along the pivot point of Y here, because it is Y coefficient of Y, right? So it now you understand that if you change the value of this constant, okay, line gets moved up and down. If you change the value of this X coefficient, then the pivot point of X will move up and down, or clockwise or anti-clockwise direction. If you change the value or the coefficient of Y, then again this pivot point at Y, either it moves clockwise or it moves anti-clockwise direction. So everything depends upon changing these values 2, 3 or minus 7 here. Or let us rename this one as A, B and this as C, okay? Why it happens like that? You see here, suppose, let us see with this example, 2x plus 3y plus minus 7 equal to 0. Okay, this is given. So it is minus 7, right? So the area here is for X is like 7/2, and this area, this side, it is 7/3. Now if you take this one, it means that here it is X equal to 0 and Y equal to 7/3, and here it is Y equal to 0 and X equal to 7/2. Now let us see, okay, on increasing the value of 2, on increasing the value of 2 now, okay, if you increase this value of 2, the denominator highlighted also increases, right? Here 2, if you increase here 3, then this becomes 3. So it means that 7/2, instead of 7/2, which is 3.5, if it is 7/3, then it becomes 2.33 something it will become. So instead of 2.5 to 3.5 to, it becomes 3. Something like that. So 3.333 it becomes like that. So it means that this value from here, it reduces, right? This value gets reduced. So this line, if you see this particular line from here, it moves somewhere here. It means that this pivot will be here now. This pivot will be here later if you see it like this. If you increase this value, okay? So on increasing the value of 2, this x coefficient, the denominator highlighted also increases, and this results to the overall decrease in the fraction, right? Decrease in this particular fraction, and the line rotates in a clockwise direction. It goes like this, right? Fine. Now, 2x plus 3y plus minus 7 equal to 0. Let us say we have a blue point in the red area. So this is, we have a randomly we have taken, okay, we have taken a equation like this, and then a line has been drawn like this. Fine, very good. The left hand side here, downside is the blue region, and the upper side is the red region. Now consider a blue point is available here. This is the blue point. How do we move this line such that the right side will be the red area and downside we have the blue area? So now what we have to do, we have to move one thing. What we can do is that we can move, okay, translate this one, or we can do some rotation such that this line should be moved very efficiently, such that, and with some rate of learning, such that this line should be covering. It means that this blue point should be under the blue region. So let us say we have a blue point in the red area, which is wrongly classified, and we need to transform and rotate, or translate and rotate the line to bring it closer to this blue region. So 2x plus 3y plus minus 7 equal to 0. First, apply translation by reducing the value of 7. For example, how do you reduce this one? So add some more points here. But how do we decide what amount it should be reduced? This is a question again, right? This is a good question again. So, but what rate we should go for reduction, decreasing or increasing of that particular C value? What should be the value of reducing or decreasing? Or in other rate, we say this one as the learning rate. How to decide what amount it should be reduced? It means that it complete based on that only, the learning rate, it moves this one up or down. Now what is this learning rate? Suppose, for example, here we take 0.1 only as the learning rate. So learning rate defines how quickly a network abandons old belief for new ones. So it means that learning rate determines how quickly one learns new things with the new data and overrides the old data. How quickly a network abandons old beliefs for new ones. Now we'll see what is the learning rate. A analogy, let us see. Let us say a child sees 10 cats. Okay, let us see that a child sees 10 cats and all of them have orange fur. So this is the cat. For example, this is the cat color that the child sees, and this cat is basically having an orange fur. Once seen, the child will think that every cat has orange hair and will look for orange fur when trying to identify a cat. So when you say cat, it means that the child sees that now that it has since already learned that whatever the cats that the child has seen, it was orange fur. So whenever you say that cat, it means that child will look only for the orange fur of the cat. Now assume that the parents of the child instructed the child that, or they showed a cat which is black in color and told that, the parents tell that this is also a cat. Then in that case, how the child will recognize, or what is the rate of learning for that particular child? Now, if you see this, with larger value of the learning rate, if the child is having a larger learning rate or if the child is having a lower learning rate, how the child will grasp this one? If, assume that if the child is having a larger value of learning rate, it will, or the child will think that orange fur is not the most important feature of cat. Rather, the black color, the black fur is the identity for the cat. If the child is having a smaller learning rate, then the child will think that this black cat is an exception or an outlier, and the cats are still orange. So you just imagine here, what is higher learning rate and what is lower learning rate? So we'll see that one also with some examples sometimes later. But please imagine that. What is this larger learning rate and smaller learning rate? So even though the child has earlier seen 10 cats with orange fur, once the parents told that they showed a black fur cat and told that it is a cat, the child has suddenly shifted the decision or the assumption from orange to black. It means that very, very high learning rate. Okay, very high learning rate. And he forgot, or even though he saw this 10 fur cats with the orange fur, he cut his assumption. He just denied that particular or ignored that particular belief, and he shifted to know that the cats are basically black in color. So when a smaller value of, with a smaller value of learning rate, the child, what he will do? He will learn slowly. Maybe like, even though parents told that this is a cat, the child will think that no, this is an exception. This is also a cat, but this is also an exception. So slowly the child. So again, maybe like slowly again, the parents tell that sometimes later that this is the cat sometimes, and with other features also taking into consideration, slowly the child will learn which one is a cat. So now you just see here, identifying a cat by the child with high learning rate and identifying the cat by the child with lower learning rate or smaller learning rate. You just imagine this, okay? These two cats. This is an analogy only. Now, what is this learning rate? Once again, we'll see here. This learning rate is basically an hyperparameter, okay? Which is basically added to the slope or concept intercepts. Or like you can say that, which is added to M and C, either to the parameters A or B or C, that controls adjusting the weights of the network with respect to any deviation from actual data, or which we call it as the loss. Now what happens? Earlier we say about a neuron, okay? When we talk about a neuron, what we did, that this is a neuron. For example, you say that this is one neuron, this is, okay, this is one input that you are giving it, okay, to a neuron here, and this is another input that you are giving to a neuron here. And this, what this neuron, so along with this input, okay, suppose I1, okay, this is I1 input 1, and this is input 2, okay, this is input 2 now. So along with these inputs, you have got weight 1 and weight 2, okay, weight 2 you are having. So it means that this is summation of I, you are giving it here. This is summation of this both, okay? Now, and you give the output, some output you give it here. The output attained, you compare with the, so there is an actual output. Okay, this is an actual output. And this is the obtained output, right? This is the obtained output, O. So actual output minus the obtained output. This is the error. This you call as an error, E. Now, this is or the loss, what we call it as the loss also, or the error, okay? So here, predicted minus actual. Or actual minus predicted, whatever may be. Either this will be a minus value or a plus value, it doesn't matter to us, okay? So how to reduce this particular error E? Now, again, what we do, these weights have been taken randomly, maybe like some bias also we give it here, okay? We give some bias also here, okay? B is the bias. So the bias, this bias and these weights need to be changed. Generally, this is WNI plus B actually, okay? This is the formula, okay? So these weights and bias need to be changed. So again, we need to change it such that this error gets reduced. Okay, error gets reduced. So this hyperparameter or the learning rate, which is added in the sense you add minus value or a plus value. Okay, added to the A, B and C or M and C. So it can control adjusting the weights of the network with respect to any deviation from actual data. So this deviation only, okay, this deviation is the you can say that the value where this error has to be this E has to be reduced, okay? So the we need to find always the optimum value of learning. So optimum value of learning should not be low enough that the final learning takes huge time and overfits the data, or it should not be high enough such that it misses the optimum and underfitting. Or you can say that let me give you a graph like this, a optimum value. Okay, what is this overfitting and underfitting? Okay, I'll speak about this overfitting and then this underfitting. Now initially the data is like this, okay, with learning rate. Okay, for example, the graph goes like this, like this, like this. You can say that this part at the initial stage of the input values, okay, or the training values, you can say the data here is underfitting. This is the particular points, okay, these points it will be underfitting. Now slowly, 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 slowly the system learns, and then assume that this is the value where optimum value, this is of learning, should not be low or it should not be high. It should not be so too low or it should not be too high. High, when the data is very high, then you can call this one as overfitting. The data, the point here is the overfitting. This is the under, okay, underfitting, and this is the overfitting. Overfitting data. Okay, the learning, the rate of learning is here, it is overfitting. The rate of learning is here, then underfitting. So when we see in other terms, underfitting means like you do not have sufficient values to predict that value. Or overfitting means the system is so huge, it takes so much time. And let me see if I can give some other good examples for this one. So let me say another figure. Let me try to draw here possibly. Suppose you are having the data like this. Now a graph is like this there. Now let us see that there is like this. OK, the data is like this with some data. OK. Now, suppose a linearly separable line is drawn like this. This is basically underfitting. OK, this is basically underfitting. We call this one. It means that the deviation, there is a high deviation of points, okay, some points from this particular line that is taken. Suppose you draw a line like this, okay, the data is like this, okay, suppose on both the sides it is there like this, okay. Now this is the optimum value, this is the optimum value. Suppose you draw in such a way that like this, okay, like this, covering all the points, for example, like this. So this becomes basically overfitting. So these curves, whatever it is given, this is overfitting, OF, okay, overfitting. And this is basically underfitting, UF. And this is this curve or parabola or whatever we give it, this is basically a optimum, okay, optimum O. Why we say this one. Now, see, in this case, what happens is that for underfitting, okay, underfitting basically, here, whatever training is there available, for that it will be, whatever training is available, for that it will be fine, okay, no doubt. But if it is like, you give it here like this, okay, it is coming here. Underfitting data here, basically always if the data is sufficient data is not trained or not available, then what happens is that here the test also it may fail. So available only for that particular samples, it may work fine, but for other samples definitely there will be a error. Now for overfitting, what happens is that for overfitting, now the graph like this, this is for example the training error, okay, this is the training error for example, or like this, the training error generally comes like this, okay, the training error. So when we take a graph like this, let me please consider this graph, the training error comes like this, like this, like this. Generally when you do training for the data, the training error comes like this, okay, this is the graph. Now the testing error, when you take the testing error, what happens is that initially it will be there like this, and it will also come down, 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 down with you. From some point of time, this testing error goes up, 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 up like this. So this is the training error, this is the testing error. So there is a, at from some point of time, some point of time, the testing error, the error, the difference between the training error and testing error is huge. This is the situation where we call it as overfitting. God may, I hope you understand this slide, okay? I hope you understand. Again, we will see this one, maybe like underfitting, overfitting and all, with some examples probably later in our, this one lectures, then you will understand more, okay? I will explain also some other time, but just you need to understand what is overfitting and what is underfitting, and just you can go through. So these are with examples I have explained to you. Now, so when we take, the learning rate, so we were discussing about the learning rate. The learning rate should be higher or it should be lower. Which one is basically a better one, whether it is higher or later one? Let us see here. So when you say higher learning rate, okay, it means that network changes its mind more quickly, okay, more quickly. It can be useful in some cases, but it isn't good if it is too high. If it is too high learning rate, then it is not so good. It is not so good. The thing is that if you take the example earlier, the child might start to think that all cats are basically black. If the child understands that earlier he saw 10 cats and then afterwards suddenly he shifted his mind, telling that when the parent showed him that the cats are basically black, or this is a cat, then the child suddenly shifts, right? Started thinking that cats are black, even though the child has seen more orange cats than the black ones. Still, the child thinks that cats are black. This is due to high learning rate. It means that the belief is changed as a phase shift. Okay. Now, if you are using a low learning rate, so the child will be learning very slowly. So using a low learning rate, what happens? The child might sound good in terms of not missing any detail. So if you are using a low learning rate, then like, for example, sometimes what happens is that you are stuck into this local minima. Suppose a graph is like this, okay? And the graph is, comes, the curve is like this, okay? Actually, this is the lowest minima, right? Or this is the global minima. Out of this, for this particular graph, this is the value, okay? This is the place where you have the lowest value, right? Low minima, global minima. We call this one as a global minima. But sometimes what happens, suppose the data is now the you are here and you need to learn, and then you have to come here. Now what happens is that when there is a high learning rate, sometimes you may jump from here to here, okay? Here to here you may jump it. And from here again you may jump this side. again jump this side. So you may not be always jumping this side and this side, but you may not enter into a global minimum always. But when you are learning, means you are having a low learning rate, then what happens is sometimes you enter into somewhere region here, or maybe like somewhere here, okay, this particular region, and you consider that, okay, this is the least value, and you will be spending most of the time in this local minima. It is not global minima, it is a local minima. So, but it could also mean that it will be taking a longer time to converge, especially if the network gets stuck on a plateau region. Plateau region is like this, okay, this is the area, and where somewhere like you get a plateau like this, and then okay, maybe like you get it like this. So this plateau region, this area, this particular region where the system may get stuck, wasting most of the time. So maybe like in the earlier example, when we consider, the child was will think, okay, all still, even though parents told that this is a cat, okay, they showed him a cat, and they showed the black cat, and showed the told that this is a cat, the child started thinking very slowly. It means that very, if the child is having a low learning rate, then what probably he starts exploring some other things like features, unnecessary features like length of the nail, like what is the length of the nail, whether it is a big one, sharp nail, whether it is a short nail, whether it is what is the size of the nail, what is the dia of the nail, okay, all these things are like the ear type, maybe like the ears are wide open, whether it is sprawled down, or maybe like whether it is sharpness in the ear edge, something like that, or big ear, small ear, like that, or the fur type, whether it is soft or whether it is hard, or whether it is the like the fur color, many things considering, or the body temperature, what is the temperature, high temperatures, low temperatures, like that. So this the child keeps on thinking about unnecessary features like that. If it is a very small learning rate or lower learning rate, so it signifies that you are not rushing into any decisions quickly and making sure you gradually learn all the variations in the data. But you understand one thing, that so much time is being spent here, right? So much time is being spent here if you are having a lower learning rate. A higher learning rate also, sometimes what happens is that it is good, sometimes it is good, but always it is not good, because you may enter into wrong assumptions. So we said that if you are having, as we say that we may go into enter into overfitting or underfitting. So we need an optimum learning rate, a learning rate which is good enough so that little bit faster we try to converge to a solution, but at the same time we do not go for overfitting or we do not go for underfitting. Now coming back to the running example, so we have a line here, right? This is the line here that is given here, okay? That line, what we need to do for this particular line, it has to be shifted such that this blue point comes under this blue region. Okay, so reducing the value of 7 by learning rate 0.1 moves the line up and closer to the line. So it means that this moves up. So how do we do? Suppose for this value, we are reducing the value by 0.1. It means that -7 -0.1, it is -7.1. okay, suppose we do that, what happens now? So what happens, the line was here somewhere and it moved up, okay? It moved up. If you see here, earlier it was here, okay? The line was here, the line is here, but this value basically reducing, it will move up. Now this example has been given, this is basically shifting has been given for this two, actually x-intercept, okay? Now sorry, x coefficient. So similarly, reducing 0.1 from both 2 and 3, here 2 and this 3, reducing 0.1 from 2 will rotate the line along the pivot in anti-clockwise direction. So earlier the line was here, right, somewhere, and it just moved up, or it moved this side. It means that the line moved up, okay, reducing the value of 0.1, it has moved in the anti-clockwise direction, this side. Similarly for 3, okay, for 3, suppose we reduce it. We reduce it for 3 is -0.1. The line, earlier it was here and it moved into the clockwise direction, okay? It moved up like this. So now you just imagine that reducing 0.1 from 3 will rotate the line along the pivot in a clockwise direction, and the equation now is 1.9x plus 2.9y plus minus 7.1 equal to 0. So you repeat this step again in such a way, again and again, till the point gets on the blue side of the line. After each iteration, the line gets closer to the point, right? It goes point, it just moves upward like this. Now, the perceptron learning algorithm is given here like this, with step one, start with a random line. At step one, you start with a random line, that is ax plus by plus c equal to 0. Okay, you can start any line, anywhere randomly you take up a line, ax plus by plus c equal to 0. Now, what you have to do is that step two, pick a large number. Okay, this number is the number of repetitions that we have to do for the entire data set or scanning the entire data set. Sometimes we call this one as an epoch. Okay, in technical terms, in machine learning, we call this one as an epoch. Okay, so what is epoch? One epoch is defined as one pass over the entire data set for the complete data set. Okay, 10 epochs means you have used your data set or you are scanned through your data set 10 times. Okay. We'll see this algorithm. So what exactly is epoch? If you see, one epoch is when the entire data set has passed forward and backward through the neural network once. Okay. If you see here an example, so increasing the number of epochs results in the increase in the number of times of changes in weights in the neural network, and the curve goes from underfitting to optimal to overfitting. So as I said, curves goes like this, down, down, down. From underfitting, it goes down like that to optimum, and then it goes to overfitting. Okay, if you see here now, for this, for example, in a stock of pile of hay here available, the person started searching for a needle in this pile of hay. Searching. So one round he found, he did not, he looked completely once for the complete hay pile, he did not get. Again, he has moved around, he did not get, like that. So suppose assume that this guy has told that I have found it, I have found the needle. So this guy is telling that congratulations, it took you 100 epochs to search the needle. 100 epochs means 100 times he moved throughout completely this hay pile, front and back like that. Okay, for the complete iterations. 100 times he has moved like that. So we have few examples to be said here. Like, what is this epoch versus batch size versus iteration? Few things that you need to know. See, what happens is that now, as earlier I have said you, that when you are doing the learning, okay, when the learning is being done, what happens is that you have to find out or optimization. Now, suppose, as I said, use that this is the graph. Okay, this is the graph, and the curve is like this. For example, the curve is like this, and like this, and like this, and then like this, and then it goes up like this. Okay, this is the curve, and you need to, suppose you are here somewhere. Okay, you are here somewhere. This is plus symbol, is you are here somewhere. Okay, now, so this one, in order to reach this one, generally we say, or sometimes it is given like this also. Okay, if it is a curve is given like this, we say that we use some optimization technique to reach at this global optimum. Generally in machine learning concepts, we understand or we study about that one as a gradient descent problem. Okay, so this gradient descent is an iterative optimization algorithm which can be used in machine learning to find the best minima of the curve. Okay, basically, when we say about gradient, what do we mean by a gradient? In conventional machine learning terminology, gradient means the rate of inclination or declination. Inclination either moving up or coming down, okay, of a slope, basically, for a slope. And descent means descending or coming down, okay, either coming down or going up in such a way that you wanted to achieve the best global minima. Okay, this is the best global minima. So when we say epoch, if you say here epoch, then batch size, we have few things. Okay, epoch, batch size, iteration. Now we have complete data set. Okay, assume that we are having a complete data set. This complete data set, everything, if you are going through once like this, okay, complete scanning over the complete data set, we call this one as an epoch, right? We call this an epoch. Now this complete data set cannot be fed into the memory at a time. Sometimes what we do is that we divide the data set into maybe like suppose three, some batches, okay, and batches. This is batch one, okay, this is batch one, this is two, okay, this is three, okay, three batches. Now three batches, it has been divided into three batches here. Now this is the number of batches. Three is the number of batches, and batch size is how many records are there available in this particular one batch. This is batch size, BS, okay, batch size. So here you say one epoch is one iteration forward or backward over the entire data set, complete data set. And batch size is the number of training examples in one forward and backward pass. Okay, for the batch size. So if you are having 50,000 training data and the batch size is 1,000, it means that 50,000 divided by 1,000, then you get 50 iterations to complete one epoch. 50 iterations, iteration one, iteration two, iteration three, like that. So you need three iterations here to complete the complete one epoch, one complete epoch. So one iteration is the number of passes. So what is one pass again? So you need to understand here, what is this one pass? Okay, if you say one pass is one forward pass. Forward and backward combined together only, you make it as one pass. For the data set, okay, is one forward pass plus one backward pass. So forward pass and backward pass are not counted as two different passes, but they are considered as a single pass. You need to understand this one. Suppose like given, maybe like in the next, it is given like this. Next slide, it is given. Suppose, so let us say you have data set of 10 examples, okay, 10 samples. You have a batch size of two running for the three epochs. Then for each epoch, you have five batches. Okay, for each epoch, you have five batches. It means that 10 divided by 2 is the batch size, that equal to 5. Now each batch size get passed through the algorithm, therefore 5 iterations per epoch. Now you understand that there are 5 epochs, iterations per epoch. So epochs, total number of epochs is equal to 3, means total so here total number of epochs required is 15, or 3 means total number of iterations for training is, if epochs equal to 3, it means the total number of iterations required for the training is 15. That is 5 number of batches into 3 times the epochs. So 5 into 3 equal to 15. So total number of iterations required are 15 iterations required if it is 3 epochs and batch size, batch number is, or batch number of batches are 5. So if you have 1000 training examples and you have a batch size of 500, then it will take 2 iterations to complete one epoch. So we can divide, suppose a data set of 2000 examples and batch size of 500 is there, it will take 4 iterations to complete one epoch. Simply. Getting me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So the perceptron learning algorithm is very simple here again. If you see here, perceptron learning algorithm, step one, we select a random line, AX plus BY plus C equal to 0. And step two, you pick the number of epochs that you want to run to the database, run through the database. That is the, pick a large number here generally, okay? And step three is you choose the learning rate. Assume that we have taken here 0.01 as the learning rate. And now the algorithm starts actually the loop for 1500 times, or for the number of epochs that has been considered, pick a random point. somebody is a little bit on, your speaker is on, or this one, you can please mute it. Okay, fine. Thank you. So you for repeat this operation, this particular operations or steps for the number of epochs that is being chosen, like pick a random point. Okay, pick any point. Suppose you have to take this particular point, or you take this particular point. Okay, this particular point. If this point is correctly classified, it means that if it is correctly classified, this is red and it is classified as red, then it means that loss equal to zero, right? Or less loss equal to it is less than the threshold that is considered. So it means that fine, very good, no issue. If loss equal to zero, it means that the actual is equal to predicted. That is the output that you are going to get it. So it means that you do nothing. Already the line is perfectly separated, or you have the linearly separable line. The point is perfectly classified. Suppose you take any point, okay, one point which is a blue point. If it is not correctly classified, then if point P is incorrectly classified, means loss is not equal to zero. It means that there is some loss available. Then in that case, what you can do, either you can add or subtract the learning rate. Okay, this is the learning rate to A. Again, add or subtract the learning rate to B, and add or subtract the learning rate to C. Okay, this A, B and C. You can add or subtract the learning rate. Okay, to this particular A, B and C. Okay, then what happens? This we can give as a generalized formula. Okay, fine. This is. What is the time? Should we go with the another algorithm? Generalized to this one. 5:11. So I am stopping here. I will go with the perceptron learning modified algorithm in the. I'm discarding this for the time being.
Yeah, all of you can leave, please.
I'm stopping the recording.